Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Capitalism, The Story Behind the Word, by Michael Sonenscher, narrated by Liam Gerrard. Preface. Before the existence of both the concept and the reality of capitalism, there was once something called commercial society. This book is about the similarities and differences between the two terms, starting with the one that is the more recognisable. Capitalism, wrote the author of a book that was published with much the same title as this one, first in 1917 and then in 1927, is a political and polemical term that has no place in the language of scholarship. But, as one of his reviewers pointed out caustically, the assumptions underlying the claim seem to mean, therefore, that words like religion, liberty, or patriotism also had no place in the language of scholarship, because they too could be taken to be political and polemical terms. Nor, the same reviewer continued, did the polemical character of the term or the fact that the word itself could not be found in the first volume of Karl Marx's Kapital amount to anything like a real obstacle to finding out how to understand the difference between a capitalist and a non-capitalist society. Capitalism might well be hard to define, but it was still quite easy to see. Nothing much, it seems, has changed. Capitalism is a 19th century word with a 21st century charge. Although it is still quite hard to define, it remains quite easy to see. One reason for this mixture of the obvious and the opaque is the range of subjects encompassed by the word. Capitalism certainly calls for capital, but it is not quite so obvious that it also has to call for capitalists rather than, for example, organised businesses, managerial hierarchies, paid workers, multiple consumers, limited liability, incorporated stock, financial services, competitive markets, and bureaucratic states. Capitalism also seems to call for industrial organisation, technical specialisation, and the division of labour, but it is not quite so obvious that it also has to call for markets, prices, profits, and dividends. Capitalism, finally, seems to call for producers, products, and processes, but it is not quite so obvious that it also has to call for coercion, classes, and conflict. Sometimes it seems to have called for them all, but it seems never to have done so all at once, or settled into something fixed and determinate all at the same time, and all in the same place. Capitalism clearly has something to do with making things, whether making cars or making money, but capitalism itself is not ready-made. Capitalism, in short, is a compound term. In this respect, it has something in common with the many different clusters of concepts, values and ideologies that have, for example, been given the names of communism, nationalism, socialism, liberalism, conservatism, feminism, imperialism, or environmentalism. Capitalism is one of them. Like them, it is a word that ends in ism, and, as a 19th century dictionary put it, this means that it has a systemic quality. Words ending in ism, the dictionary noted, referring here to the word atheism, were systemative, meaning that they indicated a system, a doctrine, a way of acting, thinking, or doing things. Although, as another authority pointed out in the course of discussing the word realism, the ending made the words excessively vacuous. It was still likely that they would be used by the public as markers or milestones to make it easier to label or classify people or doctrines, because this, remarkably, was what the ending could do. Behind the generic quality of the ending, however, there was still an endless variety of conceptual content and a ramifying array of overlapping genealogies of semantic origin. In this respect, too, capitalism is one of them. One of the aims of this book is to describe how the many heterogeneous components of the concept of capitalism came to be crystallised as a single word. This, in the first instance, calls for identifying where the different ingredients of the compound came from, and, second, for explaining how, when, where, and why they came to be connected to and articulated with one another. Part of this story has already been told, initially by Richard Passo, the author of the book mentioned in the first paragraph of this preface, and in somewhat more detail in a now-forgotten article published in 1940 by a Swiss historian named Edmund Zilberner in the prestigious French historical journal Annales, edited by Marc Bloch and Lucien Febvre. In this article, Silberner showed that capitalism began as a French word, coined in the 9th, 1850, edition of a famous pamphlet by the French socialist Louis Blanc entitled Organisation du Travail, or The Organisation of Labour, as the English language translation was entitled. Although Silberner did not explain why Blanc began to use the term, or what he intended it to mean, he did, however, single out the fact that, in coining the word, Louis Blanc made a point of juxtaposing capitalism to capital. "Cry out," Blanc wrote, "long live capital. Long may we applaud it, and long may we go on to attack capitalism, its mortal enemy, with even more intensity. Long live the goose that lays the golden egg, and long may we protect it from anyone seeking to eviscerate it." It is not usual now to think of capital and capitalism as mortal enemies. One of the further aims of this book is to try to show what this meant and begin to explain why the conceptual opposition on which it was based has come to look so strange. The initial reason for both can, however, be set out briefly here. This is the fact that Silberner's discovery was not entirely accurate because, long before Louis Blanc made use of the term in 1850, both the word and the concept of capitalism were initially associated with the related subjects of power politics, war finance and public debt. The word capitalist actually began as an 18th century French word, capitaliste, that was usually applied to someone who lent money to one or other of the many branches of the French royal government to fund the costs of war. The original English language equivalent of a capitaliste was, therefore, an annuitant or a stockholder, rather than a capitalist. The English word came later. As will be shown in later chapters, the opposition between capital and capitalism on which Louis Blanc drew was bound up with this earlier usage. Gradually, however, the earlier usage also came to be bound up with a number of other clusters of concepts, values, and ideologies that, cumulatively and sequentially, came to form the moral and political context in which both the word and the concept of capitalism first arose. Some were connected to the subjects of property, inequality, and what came to be called the social question. Others were connected to the subjects of industry, the division of labour and global trade. Still others, however, continued to be connected to the subjects of money, credit, and public debt. From the vantage point of 18th century usage, however, capitalism did not have to wait for the publication of the Communist Manifesto to acquire the apocalyptic aura that it still can have. The aura was there right from the start. One reason why this aura has lasted is that alongside the concept of capitalism, there was another concept with a rather different set of connotations. This was the concept of commercial society. It had rather less to do with the subjects of war and debt that, as will be shown, formed the original context in which the concept of capitalism first appeared, because the concept of commercial society was associated instead with the subject of the division of labour. Over the course of the 19th century, however, the two concepts began to merge. Discussions of capitalism in the context of the subjects of war and debt sometimes gave rise to predictions of either the end and dissolution of established political societies or the establishment of a universal empire under the aegis of a powerful and determined royal or republican government. Discussions of capitalism in the context of the subject of the division of labour also gave rise to predictions of either the end and dissolution of established political societies or the establishment of a domestic political empire, this time under the aegis of a new incarnation of a Roman Caesar, as the combined effects of economic inequality and social isolation took their toll. The modern concept of revolution encompassed them both. The fusion gave an extra charge to the title of Marx's most famous publication, the Communist Manifesto, because a manifesto was, originally, the name reserved for a declaration of war. Quite a number of steps are required to explain how the subject of the division of labour came to be associated with the subjects of war and debt, and, by extension, class war. One of the initial aims of this book is to describe how these steps occurred, because several of them have now been forgotten. In the 21st century, the concepts of capitalism, commercial society and the division of labour are usually associated with the economic and political thought of Adam Smith. In the early 19th century, however, the concepts of commercial society and the division of labour were associated as readily with the thought of a now much less well-known French royalist writer named Louis de Bonald. The Communist Manifesto brought the two sets of concepts together. The analytical starting point of this book is, therefore, a question about whether the concepts of capitalism and commercial society were, in fact, the same. It is followed by a further question about how to think about politics, if, in fact, they were not. The two questions derive from a third, more fundamental question. This question arises from the conceptual overlap between capital, war, and debt on the one side, and capital, commercial society, and the division of labour on the other. It is a question about whether what has come to be called capitalism was initially understood to be something that could offset or neutralise, rather than magnify or exacerbate, the effects of the division of labour. This is because the apocalyptic aura now usually associated with capitalism was initially associated with the concept of commercial society. In this respect, Louis Blanc was the inadvertent intellectual heir of Louis de Bonald. Capitalism, Blanc asserted, was the mortal enemy of capital. To Bonald, writing two generations earlier, the mortal enemy was commercial society. Others, however, like the Austro-German-Danish political economist Lorenz von Stein, took a different approach. If capitalists and capital were once associated with warfare, they could also be associated with welfare. From this perspective, the real mortal enemy, in Louis Blanc's terminology, was neither capital nor capitalism, but the division of labour. Capitalism in its original meaning was the solution, not the problem, because capitalism in its original guise had more to do with public credit and state expenditure than with private property and competitive industry. In this conceptual setting, capitalism was something more than a compound term, because it was also substantially more morally and politically ambiguous than it now seems. Simply setting the names Blanc, Bonald and Stein alongside one another helps to indicate that there were more than two sides to the initial array of arguments over capitalism. This was more than a matter of the difference between warfare and welfare, because it was also a matter of a broader set of differences over economic, financial, monetary, legal and political arrangements and institutions. Over time, many of these earlier differences and ambiguities have been lost, because many of the questions that gave rise to both the word and the concept of capitalism have disappeared from historical view. By 1918, when Richard Passow published the initial version of his Capitalismus, eine begriffliche terminologische Studie, the book mentioned in the first paragraph of this preface, the initial sequence of questions about the similarities and differences involved in thinking about commercial society, the division of labour, and capitalism had already been largely forgotten. Here too, it seems, nothing much has changed. The subjects of commercial society and the division of labour belong largely to economic history, or to the history of ideas and the history of social, economic, and political thought. The subject of capitalism belongs largely to Marxism or to global history and the new historiography of capitalism. This book is about what, analytically, came before these several, apparently self-contained types of historical understanding, and, more substantively, about what was involved in thinking about commercial society, the division of labour and capitalism during the period when these three, initially separate subjects, began to be defined and discussed before, over time, they turned into one. Its aim is to indicate what thinking about politics is likely to involve once historical investigation has begun to prise these overlapping subjects apart. A summary of the argument of the whole book can be found at the end of the first chapter. Part 1. Problems. 1. Capitalism and commercial society. Before the emergence of the concept of capitalism, there was an earlier concept called commercial society. The link between the two concepts, it has usually been said, can be found in the thought of Adam Smith, because this, initially, was where the two concepts of capital and commercial society can both be found. There were, it has also been said, two main reasons for the existence of this link. The first was that Smith's concept of commercial society was the fourth of a sequence of stages made up of the various ways by which human societies have acquired their means of subsistence, a sequence that started with hunting and gathering, proceeded with raising livestock like sheep and cattle, continued with agriculture and settled communities, and culminated with commerce and industry. A commercial society was, therefore, what came after hunting, pastoral, and agricultural societies. The second reason was that the concept of commercial society fed readily into the concept of capital that played so substantial a part in Smith's best-known work, An Inquiry into the Nature and Causes of the Wealth of Nations of 1776. Commerce generated capital, just as capital generated commerce, which meant, from this perspective, that a commercial society was simply a society predicated on capital. It was, therefore, a capitalist society, or, in short, capitalism. In fact, however, a commercial society was not actually a society predicated on capital, but, as Smith himself wrote, a society predicated on the division of labour, a phrase that Smith seems to have coined, even though the concept itself was well established by the time that he wrote The Wealth of Nations. When the division of labour has been once thoroughly established, Smith wrote at the beginning of the fourth chapter of his book, it is but a very small part of a man's wants which the produce of his own labour can supply. He supplies the far greater part of them by exchanging that surplus part of the produce of his own labour which is over and above his own consumption for such parts of the produce of other men's as he has occasion for. Every man thus lives by exchanging, or becomes in some measure, a merchant, and the society itself grows to be what is properly called a commercial society. The scale and scope of the division of labour, Smith observed, was limited by the extent of the market. As it is the power of exchanging that gives occasion to the division of labour, he wrote in the first sentence of the preceding chapter, so the extent of this division must always be limited by the extent of that power, or, in other words, by the extent of the market. The division of labour and the market were therefore two sides of the same coin. They, not capital, were the initial or primary components of a commercial society. Capital came next. Smith did not make use of the term commercial society at all frequently, but, on the two occasions on which he did actually use the term, he used it to describe the attributes of a society based on the division of labour. The education of the common people, he wrote on the only other occasion on which he used the term, requires perhaps, in a civilised and commercial society, the attention of the public more than that of people of some rank and fortune. This was because people of some rank and fortune usually received an education before they began to work, but the common people began to work at an early age, and the work that they did was often too time-consuming, routine, and repetitive to be comparable with the growth of knowledge, understanding, and curiosity that education could supply. Something like the publicly funded Scottish parish school system, Smith wrote, was consequently required to provide early education in a civilised and commercial society. If, as it is sometimes assumed, a commercial society is simply a synonym for capitalism, where does this leave the division of labour? One of the main aims of this essay is to show that there is a great deal more to think about and find out about by beginning with the idea that capitalism and the division of labour are two quite distinct subjects. It is, of course, very easy to conflate the two, because the division of labour and capital are certainly closely related. But they are not quite so closely related as either the concept of capital or the phrase "the primitive accumulation of capital" have usually been taken to suggest. In this account of their origins, capital and the accumulation of capital began with war, conquest and slavery, making capitalism the product of slavery, or, alternatively, the product of feudalism, or, in other renditions, the disintegration and differentiation of household production into capital ownership by men and proletarian reproduction by women. But if conquest gave rise to capital, it is less clear why capital should give rise to the division of labour rather than, simply, to more conquest. Predatory societies do not need the division of labour to accumulate capital, because, for them, capital is simply there for the taking. In this sense, as two of Smith's near contemporaries, Montesquieu and Rousseau, both argued, the accumulation, distribution and redistribution of capital was in fact the other face of despotism. A despot could accumulate capital by imposing slavery and, subsequently, could go on to enjoy that capital unless or until it was seized by the next despot. The dynamics of capitalism and slavery were, therefore, rather different from the dynamics of the division of labour. The former did not need to involve markets, the latter did. Smith himself was well aware of the need to provide a separate explanation of the origins of the division of labour. As he described it, the market-oriented disposition to truck, barter, and trade, he gave the three words almost the same meaning, that was the key to the division of labour, grew out of the human capacity for rhetoric and persuasion. Anyone who could talk someone into doing this rather than that was inadvertently launching the division of labour. If we should inquire into the principle in the human mind on which this disposition of trucking is founded, Smith said in one of his earlier lectures on jurisprudence, it is clearly the natural inclination everyone has to persuade. As several of his contemporaries began to show, this initial, largely individual capacity to see an opportunity and turn it to broader advantage could, subsequently, become more general and durable. One of the most plausible conjectures was set out by one of Smith's most attentive early French readers, the Marquis de Condorcet, at the beginning of his posthumously published Outline of a Sketch of the Progress of the Human Mind. There, the original causal mechanism underlying the formation of the division of labour was connected, first, to the size of human kin groups, and second, to variations in the ages at which people died, rather than to something as generic as an individual capacity to use persuasive language. In these conditions, the early death of a patriarch, the absence of other adult claimants to goods left by the defunct, and the presence or absence of large numbers of helpless children could produce windfalls for some and hardship for others. Demography could, therefore, give rise to deficits or surpluses of different sizes and composition, and they in turn could become the basis of either the division of labour or the accumulation of capital, or sometimes both. There were many late 18th century variations on this type of conjectural account of the origins of the division of labour and its relationship to the accumulation of capital. Here, it is enough to emphasise that the two subjects were historically and analytically distinct. On Smith's terms, a commercial society was, substantively, a society predicated upon the existence of the division of labour, and not, at least in the first instance, on the prior existence of capital. This made the division of labour, not capital, the real historical novelty, and the real basis of a commercial society. Although capital was also central to the existence of a commercial society, its more fundamental component was, as both Smith and Condorcet indicated, its relationship to the division of labour. Unlike capital itself, the division of labour presupposed markets, and markets in turn entail prices. Markets and prices are relentless and remorseless because, unlike capital, they are not the types of thing that can really be owned. As the old Latin distinction between imperium and dominium that used to be applied to the concept of property helps to show, markets and prices could certainly be subject to commands and rules, imperium, but they were still not the types of thing that could be physically occupied or possessed in the way that a house or a field or even a body can be owned, dominium. This raises several intriguing questions about the concept of capitalism. Where did the concept come from? When and where did it begin? What did it add to the concepts of capital or a capitalist, which both existed long before the appearance of the concept of capitalism? How was capitalism different from Smith's concept of a commercial society? If, as seems likely, it really was it because capitalism was predicated on something different from the division of labour, such as, self-evidently, the private ownership of capital? If capitalism was a property theory, was the concept of a commercial society a theory of the division of labour? And if so, what difference to thinking about both or either does this make? Was capital once seen as something that could neutralise markets? And if capital was not a source of stability, how could markets be managed? In the light of Smith's identification of a commercial society with the division of labour, and the later identification of a commercial society with capitalism, what would the history of capitalism look like if the two subjects of capital and the division of labour were distinguished more fully and treated in ways that made it possible not only to explain how they interacted, but also why they have...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.